sent me a picture of him in shorts, relaxing in Florida. And I was thinking, it's only going to last a few days. We'll be back in Maine. So just suffer with the rest of it. But glad you guys are back. Our text this morning is in Matthew. We're in Matthew 1, 18 and 25. Of course, this is what we're going to talk about. We're talking about the birth of Jesus and when he came to the world. And we're going to look at a few things here. Before I read the text, we're talking about a couple being married. And yesterday we had a little celebration here. It was kind of nice, a renewal of vows. And, you know, being married a long time, especially, you get to know your partner. And it was an older couple sitting in McDonald's. Al Coffey just recently passed, and every time Debbie and I went to Sam's Club early in the morning, they were in Sam's walking around, and it was fun to see Al, and you know, him and his wife, Norma, they just walked through. But when you get older as a couple, you know each other really well. So this older couple ordered one meal, and he got an extra cup. And they went and sat down at McDonald's, and this young fellow, younger than you, Chris, was looking at them and felt kind of funny because as he watched them, the older fella split the hamburger in half and gave her half. And he counted out the fries, one for her and one for her. And he took the drink and he poured half into the cup. The young fella went over and says, "Excuse me. Would you allow me to? May I buy you folks another meal?" "No, thank you." "No. Well," he says, "you're just sitting there. She hadn't started. He's eating. She's just watching. He felt so bad." "Well, how come you're not eating?" "Is there a problem?" She said, "Yeah, he's got the teeth first." I know Dave, we could understand that. Anyways, this is about getting married. This is our text today. Getting married. Let me read the text for you. I'm reading from the ESV, verses 18 to 25. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ, Matthew 1, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband, Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has spoken by the prophet. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son. And he called his name Jesus. Let's speak to the Father for a moment. Heavenly Father, speak to our hearts this morning. Allow us to see something new, something fresh, something different. Father, encourage our hearts, not by me or anything else, but by your Spirit, speak to us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm always amazed when Paul uses those words about preaching. You know, God uses preaching, the foolishness of it, to save men's souls. And when we look at this, this is the promise of God. God made a promise that he was going to give us a Savior. Christ, actually, his birth fulfills the prophecy of Isaiah 7:14, telling us that he's going to give. And in Isaiah's time, and I don't want to drag you down through some old dusty roads. For most of you, it wouldn't mean anything at the end of the day anyhow. But Ahaz was about to be attacked by Rezin, king of Syria, and Pekah, the king of Israel. And the Lord sent Isaiah to encourage Ahaz, but Ahaz had a little bit of a, really, I'm okay, kind of fit. He was acting a little pious and refused the sign, so God gave the sign to the whole house of David. not just to Ahaz. The sign, by the way, is the birth of Emmanuel, God with us, to the Virgin Mother, Mary. When I was a young man in the service, I was a wild man. I was an idiot. I was a bum. I was not walking with Christ. I was, and when my son was born, I prayed. I didn't pray a forgiving prayer. I didn't ask the Lord to forgive me. I didn't pray repenting. I prayed for help. Because I knew the idiot that I was. And I knew in our relationship that in my son being born, I was afraid. Because I had done a lot of things that I should know. And I was afraid that maybe something would come back. There would be something wrong with my son. Lord, if there be five on both hands, two eyes, nose, ears, mouth. If there's some common sense in them, I still question that. 40 years later, and I named him, his middle name is Emmanuel. Actually, that made him Jewish, because his name is John L. Emmanuel Walsh, J-E-W. And I teased him about that ever since. But God's presence, I felt something different. His name is Emmanuel. When I was a little boy, I first read the scripture in Isaiah. It said, Emmanuel, God with us. Sometimes in our lives, we don't understand what God is doing behind the scenes, how God is working in ways that we don't have a clue. And we're out there doing whatever we do, enjoying life big and large. We got a lot of money, we're spending a lot of money. If we got a little bit, we're spending more than we're supposed to. We're standing on long lines in stores, and we're always doing something that we shouldn't. But yet God is still there. And in this text that I read for you a moment ago, there's three things that are happening here. The first is that we can see that God came to fulfill his promise because the Holy Spirit put Jesus in Mary. So by the Holy Spirit, Jesus is in this woman, this young woman. And then the scriptures confirm him. We'll look at this in a minute, verses 20 and 21. They confirm him by the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit confirms that this is the Christ. And then the third thing is that he's placed in the context. I like to say it around Galatians 4:4, you know, in the fullness of time. Perfect time Jesus came. So Matthew's gospel here, he puts them in the room. In other words, we're in this world and all of a sudden Jesus enters the room. Jesus enters the world. Jesus comes in. And you know, for some of us, for 2,000 years later, it makes it hard for us to get the fingers of our mind around the whole idea of why Jesus came. The society that we live in can't accept it, don't want it, don't want to have anything to do with it. But it's a fulfillment of God's promise, whether you take it or not. I always think of the Christmas tree at this time of year, that there's always somebody who left a gift under there and didn't take it. They didn't come and get the gift that was given, the gift of the promise. Jesus says, I love you. What we just read in those verses is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. My mother, when I was, my mother was so mad at me that if she could have thrown me out a third floor window, she would have. She was angry. She was just, and you know when you have eight kids and the oldest one's a boy, it's the only boy you got, and he's disappointing you every now and then, you just want to slug him with a sledgehammer, you know. And I forget what happened, but I tried to make it up. And I went out and I hustled around as a kid would in New York City growing up there. And I got some money for these elegant leather gloves that came up to here. I wanted mom to wear those to church. And I did everything I could and I got that box. And she opened it. She didn't know it was for me. And she opened it and she realized it was for me. Sank. I said, wow, I worked so hard.
get the money to buy those. Those were not cheap gloves.
They were real leather.
You know, those were not cheap gloves. And there's no way I can understand this in the temporal position that I am as a person, or probably you could. We're God's created beings. But I wonder how God feels emotionally. And he's given us this great, 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 the greatest gift. We don't accept it. He promised Jesus to us so long ago. The sign had nothing to do with Ahaz at the time, by the way. In Isaiah 8, 1 to 22, if you want to go on and look at it later on today, I would implore you to do so. I would encourage you to do so. God gave Ahaz his sign using the child of Isaiah to do this. But some people get that confused, and I'm not going to take you down that big theological road. But the son, for God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten son, the greatest gift he could ever give us. You know, sometimes I wonder, of course Jesus knew because he was Jesus, but sometimes do we wonder about our parents? You ever wonder about your parents, you know? Because you know how you and I go through all kinds of things in life. And there are moments that put a lot of stress on us, and there's a lot of moments and we don't have stress at all, and life is grand and life is good. But they did the same thing. They were just like us. In fact, sometimes when I'm witnessing to somebody and I'm trying to share the gospel with them, and I look at them, I ask them, what was your great-grandfather's first name? And I see so many people have to go. But they were just like, he was just like you. He lived every day. He knew the problems and the pressures of his world at the time, but he's gone. Are they going to remember you one day when you're gone? But we have parents that loved us. And here we see in this narrative, Joseph's got a problem that he doesn't understand yet. And I look at my parents and I think back to some of the situations they had in their lives. Remember, I've told you many times, Mom and Dad couldn't make ends meet. Sometimes they got them close enough to wave at each other, but ends never met. We never had enough money, 8 kids. Well, the 8th one came along 22 years after me, so that didn't bother me too much. But you know, to have that many kids in the house, things didn't always meet. And here this young couple is just starting out. God's chosen them. And how do you know that? Did you get a big letter? Somebody send you a FedEx telling you this is what's going to happen? And they kind of had to work this out little by little. So if you were Mary or Joseph, how would you have reacted to these events? If you had to put yourself in it. Wow, Lord, what are you doing? Lord God, Jehovah, what are you doing? In verse 18, let's look at it again. I pray that you still have your Bibles open. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed, for you younger people, engaged to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. She probably would have been the ages, knowing the culture and the customs at that time, between the ages of 12 or 14, 16 at the oldest. Hello, girls? Mom had me at 19. I can't imagine her having me at 16. Joseph, perhaps, probably would have been between 18 and 20. And their parents likely arranged their marriage with Mary and Joseph's consent, which is an interesting thing. Ray Vanderland, in his series That the World May Know, demonstrates this so well, because he mentions that in many of the Jewish customs, while the parents are wrangling out the details of the marriage and figuring out what catering hall they're going to rent and all that, the other stuff that goes along with it, the groom would talk to the bride that he's going to be engaged to, and he'd bring her a cup of wine. Maybe the dads and the mums are sitting over there, and he'd bring her the cup, and he'd offer it to her. I want you. And if she wanted him,
yes, Tina Turner does get into this. Some people say, what does love have to do with it? But they'd understand, and she would take the cup. And if she drank the cup, she was saying, I'll join myself with you. We'll be together. We'll be husband and wife. What a picture. When we come to the Lord's table, we start to go for theater, we move. When we come to this table once a month, what a picture. Jesus has provided the cup. This is the cup filled with my blood. This is the new covenant. Will you drink it? Will you accept the gift that's been made for you? Not only the gift of Jesus coming in the little manger, but the gift of Jesus dying and being put on a cross for you. This is the gospel. This is what's so exciting about this. This is what Jesus is doing for you and I. And this is unbelievable. And at Christmas time, we should be like getting up and dancing and singing and praising God for what he's done. So when we come to that table once a month, Jesus offers us the cup. Because the church is the bride of Christ. Church, are we willing to drink the cup and bond ourselves to him? Here's the problem, as we just read in the 18th verse. Here's this young woman that's not had any relations with Joseph beyond the fact that they've gotten engaged. What do they do now? What's he do now? Verse 19. And her husband, Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. The penalty for adultery under Old Testament law was death by stoning. And this penalty applied to infidelity during engagement as well. The law comes from Deuteronomy 22. And you know what's interesting, though, if you look at the law, I love the law if you look at it correctly. If a woman has been in this situation, they're both to be stoned. And stoned for a reason. Well, first of all, she's stoned because she didn't scream out for help if somebody violated her. She didn't go kicking and screaming and kicking where she needs to kick, kicking and keeping this guy away from her. And he's stoned because he's violated his neighbor's. So that's the reason for that stoning, and they're both put to death. And I often think back to the gospel, and there's some manuscript differences here and there in John 8, but when they brought the woman to Jesus and said, look, we caught her! Guys, you know how hard I am on the men more than the ladies. Where was the man in that story? I never told about the man that violated her. Because he's supposed to be put to death. Always blame the ladies, but men, where is that man? And of course we all know, we love to say it, you without sin cast the first stone. You know, Jesus, what did you do in that context? So he could have had her if he wanted to go all the way and go to court and pay the extra filing fees and go down to City Hall and do what he had to do. He could have had her put to death. But I love what the scriptures tell us, because this is the attitude it seemed that Joseph had. He must have loved Mary deeply. He was going to take care of this quietly. And I don't know. That's just speculation. But it shows something. It demonstrates something. Now, but think about this. In the New Testament, Joseph would have merely been required to divorce Mary and expose her to shame. Look what you did! Oh! That's rash, isn't it? That's running off half-cocked. That's not knowing the situation. But he reserved himself, and he didn't do that. The death penalty was rarely, if ever, executed for this offense in the New Testament times. But he could have asked for it. But a woman with child, think about this, a woman with child divorced for such infidelity would be hard-pressed ever to find another husband. leaving her without means of support if her parents died. She would have been hung out there on the line and left to dry, wouldn't she? But because divorces could be effected by a simple document with two witnesses, at that time, Joseph could have divorced her without making her shame more widely known. It was necessary, by the way, to involve a judge only if the wife were the one requesting that the husband divorce her, which is not here. But much later, rabbinic tradition charges that Mary slept with another man. You know why? Because that would take away the virgin birth. I've talked to some Jewish scholars. I've been very fortunate over the years in Brooklyn. And they always say, that scripture's translated wrong. It's a young maiden. But let me think. Young maiden doesn't mean married either. So does a young maiden have the right to just have a relationship with any man she wants to? It doesn't mean anything? Well, no. Hello? Yeah, you're right. No is the right answer. She's a virgin. She's supposed to be a virgin. And she was a virgin. You see, that's the key to this. This is showing that God's promise is with his power. And sometimes you and I forget these things. And when we're going through the problems of life, we forget that God has the power to take us through. When a young boy, and most of you know my propensity to find an old movie to watch. I love old movies. I remember the old original Titanic. The first talkie one. So moving, even as a young kid, to hear that band play, Nearer My God to Thee, as the ship was listening. The end is near for some. The end is near for many. Nearer My God to Thee. But tragedy does not have to be the way to come close to God. When problems affect us in life, tragedies like this, would that send you running? No. Joseph had someone come to him. God intervened. And what is so neat is verse 20. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Now, if I was with the kids at the chess club on Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday nights as I am, the voice of the angel would have said, dude, dude, hold on. Don't get crazy. Don't do anything rash here. God's hands in this. God has done this. God has allowed this to her. Nothing's going to happen. You just need to step up. Or what I like to say, you need to man up. Take this woman to be your wife. It's funny that as we look at life sometimes when we make decisions, and did we involve God in our decision? Or did we just run off and do whatever we thought we should do? What felt right? Debbie and I were watching, I'm going to show that we're going backwards instead of forwards. We watched the original, 1940, when you were a kid. So at 19, we watched it, and you know, when starlight, first star I see tonight. You know, is that how people are going through life? Just on a wish? Just on a whim? Is God involved in this at all? Well, if I cross both fingers and I'm stuck on this track, that train coming may not hit me, you know? I mean, is that how life is for you? Or are you doing like Proverbs 3, 5 to 6? Trusting in the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your spirit. Trusting in him. Meaning not under your own understanding, but in all your ways, acknowledging him. Now, I know that word is hard to deal with, those three little letters. All. In all your ways. In all your ways. Most of you know, I've said it many times, how I answer the phone. Lord, I don't know who's ringing. Now we do a little more. We caller ID. By the way, I duck a lot of calls. California, but they've gotten slick. Every now and then an 843 number comes up and I answer it, and it's them. I don't know how they do that. But for years and years and years, I pray. I don't know who's on the phone, what this conversation is going to be about, but give me your grace. Give me what I need to deal with this conversation. Let me love them. Like Christy Engel says, simple love, love simple. You know, let me do that when I'm talking to them. Let me do what I need to do. It's not easy sometimes. I've had people get irate on the phone. I shared with David yesterday a joke about a guy who he took an AT&T operator to the cleaners. I'm sorry, I hope it doesn't affect Ray and Kathy's retirement. But AT&T just kept on going. Somebody called up and says, we offer you 10 cents a minute. For every minute of the day, 24 hours, 365 days a year. And the guy's thinking, she never said rate. And the thing goes on and on and on, but he's got a calculator out. He says, well, when do you send the first check? What check? Well, you said you're going to give me 10 cents an hour, I mean 10 cents a minute, you know, for so many, every day, 24 hours a day, you know, 365 days. When do I get the first check? Or are you going to send me a lump sum? And the woman said, no, you don't understand. And he kept her going and going and going and going. And it goes on. There's no proverb that says, with thy understand, with all thy getting, get understanding. As we rush into this holiday, with all our getting, we have an understanding of who Christ is and what has been done on our behalf. You see, as we pray and ask the Lord to help us and walk us through this, sometimes we get caught up in just, this has got to be about me. And it's not about him and what he's done. He's done it all. And we get upset. Jesus came to deliver his people from personal sin and thus to deliver them from its judgment. You and I were dead people walking before we met Christ. We were on a death row. We had no hope. We had nothing. And then Jesus, at some point in your life, entered the room. You realize how much he loved you and you accepted him. Verses 22 and 23, let me take you there. In 22, all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. And they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Here we have the living God. This is what John's gospel is so pointed about in that first chapter, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten Son of God. Jesus came. He's here. He's here for you and I. Emmanuel, or God with us, more aptly points to the right kingly side of David. Did you hear when the angel came to Joseph, son of David? He was in the kingly line. Matthew is writing, showing us that Jesus is King Jesus. We have a king to worship. Come quickly, Lord Jesus, our King. And sometimes because everything else we get caught up into, we miss that also. Verse 24, when Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but he knew her not until she had given birth to a son. And he called him. Jesus came to be with us, to show us that God loved us that much. He showed us how we need to live and that we can live the life that God asks us to live. And then, to make everything right, he paid the price as being the sacrifice for our sins. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And we know the gift of God is eternal life. That's what Jesus came to bring us. I grieve at this time of year for people who do not know the Savior. I grieve for them. I worry for them. Not that I sense that you worry about something. I'm hoping, I guess, would be a better word.
they would come to hear somebody tell them about Jesus. Tell them the old story, but not the old stories necessarily, but tell them the gospel. Give them the gospel that Jesus died for you. I ran into a woman this week. The week prior, I didn't know her granddaughter belonged to one of my school clubs there at Holbrook. And I'm a little boy, and her, the granddaughter, had gotten into a conversation, and suicide came up. And my ears went right up. You're trained for that, by the way, by the school district, and right away I'm looking, and the little girl broke into tears and bolted out of the room. And the little boy couldn't understand what was making everything such a problem, and he went into some kind of retreat and ended up walling up in a corner. I'm thinking, boy, these kids are too young for these kinds of emotions. And then this week, I ran into this woman who happened to be the grandmother. Come to find out, somebody I've known for a long time. Known her from my Eastbrook days. Knew her mother. Her husband had been dealing with an illness. And he didn't want to put the family through. This little young girl is dealing with this tragedy. Her and her brother loved their papa. Loved him often. So I had the opportunity to sit with this woman I've known. I hadn't seen her in a long time. We talked about the story, what had happened. And she said something that really bothered me a little bit. And this is where I reached out. I wasn't in the place to talk to her, to counsel her the way I wanted to. And I'm praying that I'll get the opportunity. But in the few moments we sat there, she said, you know, he was in two different worlds. He was in the world where he put on the good face and he'd secretly go to the psychiatrist on how to deal with this sickness that he had, terminal sickness. He didn't let the family in on what he was going through. He didn't know how to deal with the suffering, but he put this nice facade on and not really let anybody know that he was dying. So to make it easy for them that they wouldn't have some long process of caring for him. He ended it quickly. The reason I ask us to pray this morning for our loved ones who don't know Christ is because people are dying without understanding the promise God made of giving us a deliverer. And those people, they're going to get help from people who will say, follow your instinct. Follow your heart. Oh, what does Jeremiah say about our hearts? They're wicked. Follow your whims. Go the way the winds blow. Go as you want. No one says to them, there's always hope. Peter says it so well when he says, always be prepared to give a reason for the hope that's in you. As we remember God's promise of giving us a son who would be a savior, and you've heard me say this many times, if we had financial trouble, he would have sent us a financier. If we needed educating, he would have sent us an educator. If we needed saving, he sent us a savior. He sent us his son, Jesus Christ. As you go through this season, as you think about those people that are around you, those people that don't know the answer, who don't know the gospel, don't be afraid to tell them. Love them. Show them. And if you have to, remind yourself constantly. constantly of Paul's words in Romans 1:16, because he says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation. All you have to do is tell me, Jesus loves you. He wants you. We have it out on the sign. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. So you are without Christ, and you need him in your life to face the problems of each and every day. As I always ask you, would you do me a favor today? Would you think on these things? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace, mercy, and love. We thank you for how great a God you are. Father, we know that there are many who hear the message, but so few that take it. We know that the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But we pray that we who know the joy of Christmas, the joy of new life, the joy that came into the lives of Mary and Joseph, can be in each life that is willing to say, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today. Come in this day. Father, be with us today and carry us through this day as we celebrate the Christ. We pray this in the name of Emmanuel.